Okay, welcome one and all again. We have had a wonderful time yesterday, and today it's going to be even better, let's hope. And we are going to have a musical day today, and we are also going to hear poetry readings from the alumni and research scholars. It's going to be an exciting one. So I think we've all refreshed ourselves with the tea. You all look so sleepy, and also we'll just do some quick, to break the ice. So I'm going to say good morning, and you're going to reply as loud as you can, okay? Good morning, everyone. Okay, it's still sleepy, so I'll just go one more time. Good morning. Okay, good. Okay, our program will go like this. We will hear a solo performance from Larim Siami Nunui. She is here, followed by Sidlarin Zuala Amtea. And then we will have a musical event. We have three judges, with us. Dr. Henry Lalmoy Zuala, Assistant Professor PUC, is here with us. And Amtea and Nunui will be the three judges for the musical events. The third semesters and the first semesters are going to perform, so we can't wait for that. And we will have readings from alumni and research scholars of the department. And at 12:50, hopefully, we will have yesterday once more. I'm very sure that we've had a wonderful time yesterday, as you can remember, like memories down the lane across the years, where we have speakers dragging us down to memory lane, and then we have a good time laughing about it. So we will go yesterday once more. So to start with our program, we will call upon Larim Siami Nunui. She is currently the research scholar of this department. And the song that she is going to sing is Thank You, Lord. And it's a very beautiful song. And since we are celebrating the Ruby Jubilee celebrations, I think it's a very wonderful song choice that you have here. So give it up for Nunui.
Hello. To take this opportunity to thank the department for all it has given me. So thank you. And I think we all have a lot to be thankful for today, so I hope you join me through this song.
While the world looks upon me as I struggled alone, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart, I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing. Good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing. They're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And to me, that's all that matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing. There's a roof up above. above me. I have a good place to sleep. There is food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings.
Yes, thank you, Nunui, such a wonderful, talented singer we have in our department, and so much more that the department holds in. Next up, we have another singer. He is a great singer that we all know, and the Highland Voice. Okay, I'm sorry about that. It just slipped in my mind. The Highland Voice. Ate po am kan lang melshet to ah azai tiam mm maya, and he is with us today. So we are gonna call upon him, and the song that he is going to sing is Radiohead. Creepa nilaw niya. Oh, the song that he is going to sing is Perfect, which was sung by Ed Sheeran, and this song is requested by Professor Margaret Sozama here, and it's a beautiful song. It's perfect, so it suits us, right? So give it up for Amtea.
Hello. Yeah, this song has been selected by ma'am, and I actually love this song because it's a very sweet and loving song, which I think we can all relate to. This is called Perfect.
Found a love for me, darling, just dive right in, follow my lead.
Can you make it louder?
I found a girl, beautiful and sweet. I never knew you were that someone waiting for me. 'Cause we were just kids when we fell in love, not knowing what it was. I will not give you up this time. Darling, just kiss me slow. Your heart is all I own, and in your eyes you're holding mine. Maybe I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, listening to our favorite song. And said you looked a mess. I whispered underneath my breath, but you heard it. Darling, you look perfect tonight. Well, I found a woman stronger than anyone I know. She shares my dreams. I hope that someday I share a home. I found a love carry more than just my secrets, to carry love, to carry children of our own. We are still kids, but we're so in love, fighting against all odds. I know we'll be alright this time, darling. Just hold my hand, be my girl, I'll be your man. I see my future in your eyes, baby. I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, oh, listening to our favorite song. When I saw you in that dress, looking so beautiful, I don't deserve this. Darling, you look perfect tonight. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. Baby, dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, oh, listening to our favorite song. I have faded what I see, now I am met an angel in person, and she looks perfect. I don't deserve this, she looks perfect tonight. Oh, oh, oh.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amdea. Amdea, you look perfect today, by the way. So, you always look perfect, right? He always look perfect. Anyway, we will move on to the musical events that we have, and we are going to have performance from the first semester and the third semester. I believe this is a band. Yes, and we are going to have three judges, and I will call out their name. I think they can judge from their own seat, yeah. So, but we will have an introduction, so please welcome Dr. Henry Lelmoy Zola, the assistant professor of Patunga University College. And as we all know, he has just finished his PhD, and he is a member of Besi Choir. We know Besi Choir, right? Yes. Besi Choir, Ayan member, he 2001 to 2004, King Kanania, and then from 2005 to 2010, that is a period of 5 years, he was the conductor. Okay, and the next one is Amtea Sirarin Zuala. He is currently the research scholar here in this department. And the third one, Nunu Ihlerem Siami. Kovela, Kovel kan diri ngota. Mizoram angpon entai la tun anga judge cha hi zukan nei don lo shim shim a zu bang zu first semester le third semester le chan le anga yang o. Okay, we will call the first semester first. I don't know who they are. Please come and we will have an introduction, short introduction of your band. Lo chuak ro ule. Tu teng ei ni le first semester te kanom em. Yeah, they're coming. Oh, they're hiding there. I don't know. Okay. Oh, okay. The third semester will go first. Third semester. Please welcome the third semesters.
Okay, good morning, everyone. We're students from the third semester, and my name is Lauren Boresailo, and this is Mimi. So, today we're going to sing two songs, Imagine by John Lennon first. So.
Mm-hmm. say I'm a dreamer.
And the second song is Time by Pink Floyd. Behind you again. Every
of troll in iron bound. He holds a faithful truth and is to hear him softly spoken magic spell.
Thank you.
Thank you, third semester. That was so moving and so melodious. Imagine by 1971, time 1974, and you bring back us to that moment, and we are very thankful to that. And we will call upon the first semester students, please come.
From first semester, and it is Fakar. And today we'll be performing only one song, as we didn't have enough time to prepare. So I beg your forgiveness in advance. And the song we'll be performing is "Let It Be" by the Beatles.
First semester students, thank you. Wonderful performance, a very delightful one. And to proceed with our program, we will call upon Michelle Ropuye, the third semester, from third semester.
Hello.
Thank you, Michelle. Michelle Ropui, third semester, wonderful song. That was a song called Stay by Rihanna. And moving on, we have readings from alumni and research scholars. This is going to be an exciting one. So as the lectern is set up, we have a couple of readings to be heard today. And today we have a wonderful person, an esteemed poet, Mona Zote, with us, and she will take the lead. And as we can see, I'm just going to ask our students here, do you know the motto of our university? Yes? And do you happen to know who composed them? And she is with us here, and Mona Zote is the one who has given us greater deeds remains. So we will invite her to the lectern. She'll take her turn, and let us welcome her with a big clap.
Is it afternoon? Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, first of all. I mean, I think I have a bit of a speech to make for, you know, towards the Department of English, MZU. Thank you very much for inviting us, me included, to the Ruby Jubilee celebrations that I've been hearing about since last year, as a matter of fact. So here we are, this is the reality, and we are all here, and this is great. I wasn't expecting a reading, and I brought a few things. I won't be reading too much, because I think I'm enjoying the singing part of it much more than anything else. So the first thing that I'd like to say is that as part of the, you know, I am part of the alumni of English Department MZU, and so I'm very familiar with quite a number of those of your teachers, your faculty, your esteemed faculty, in fact. And so I would also like to add that I don't know, for some reason people keep on saying that I'm a poet, so I suppose maybe I am. But I would like to say something right now, which is that I remember distinctly, although I was always writing and scribbling and whatnot, it was actually P. Maggie, Professor Margaret Zaba, who had one day when I was still a student in the department, and she said, Mona, do you write? And I said, yeah, I've been writing some poems. So she said, you know, why don't you give them to me? Because I think it was the Northeast Writers Forum that had been looking for submissions for the journal. And so I did. And then for some reason, they liked the things. And I got to know the other writers of the forum, many of whom I think are in your syllabus. Robin Ngangom, Mamang Dai, people like that. So it's really, I mean, I have never really mentioned, because it's things just kept happening. And but I would really like to say that, yes, Professor Zama, although I was the one who wrote, but you were the one who gave me that first push of the boat. So thank you very much, really. I'll be reading a couple of not very long things. So it's actually I tend to go on and on when I write, so I'm trying to look for something I had, something that is, I thought it'd be kind of suited for today, but I have a feeling that I might not have brought them here. Excuse me. Okay, I'll just start with something that I wrote some time back, and this was it's something it's a poem that, you know, I've been one of the things that I've never wanted to really comment on, although I do it a lot on posts here and there on social media. But in poetry, I try to avoid, not exactly consciously avoid, but I don't talk about whatever's happening on the mainland, as we say, although that's a place that I'm very familiar with. But in recent years, if we've been keeping up with things that have been happening there, we know that there has been quite a change in the what we'd call the social fabric of the country. And people have been just randomly killed for no reason other than their religion. They were wearing, you know, the wrong colors, so to say. And I think that's a very distressing turn that our country has taken. So I will start off with this rather not very happy poem, but it's one of the newer ones, which I think nobody here has heard, so. And this is, I wrote this after this, there was a killing of a young man, of a very young man, I think he was 15 or 16, on a train. It was Eid, the Muslim festival, and he was going back home after going to the market and buying all the things for the for the celebrations. And there was just a crowd of people who simply killed him. And that's not something that, that has really been stopped either. So this is called Poor Boys. Is the sound okay? I have been thinking about you, Junaid. Thinking about how someone said, make a noise, be witness to this moment. He was madder than hell, you bet. But I ask you, Junaid, as you lie in an untidy heap, why would I write about you when I know there will be others following close behind? We will see more boys, the poor boys. We will hear their laughter, their chatter, the banter and clatter when they pile through the door, rushing out, and go straight onto newspapers that the rain will mulch by night, or that a mother will use to wrap a couple of sweets that she bought against your return, boy. And now a fat black fly sticks to their sweetness as if charting an unblinking eye. The sun slumps on. There will be more boys and flies to cover them. Having lost the comfort of cigarettes, I remain contemplating these fingers, clean and free of stain. That's it, that's one poem. So I cannot find the one that I was supposed to be reading next. So I'll read this, it's slightly longer. This will be the second one and the last one because I have a bit of a throat infection and I don't feel like, I don't want to stress out my vocal cords too much since I'll be singing later, as I assume. Okay, second poem. This is also rather recent. Boat building. The question of being drowned or afloat does not really matter. These days you can hear it, how everyone is building boats, how you can walk down the cramped streets and hear above the everyday the sound of someone deploying a hammer steadily as she goes, a sound soaring clear above all else. I think he's building a boat. He needs to go away. He wants to make sure everyone is safe because the water's rising. Maybe he needs to bring something back home, things we need, things he thinks we need. Maybe it's a shipment of warm sweatshirts. Maybe it's a good politician or two. Maybe it's all this gold everyone is so wild about. Maybe it's oranges from those other hills. And sometimes above the laughter of this man, you see a startled cloud of birds bursting out from their sloppy nests in a brief blind whirl of instinct, ringing the air around the house that alarmed them, forgetting soon in their own way what they were afraid of just seconds ago because they're easily distracted. So today or yesterday, I went shopping. I noted many things. First, how the shopkeepers look up with eyes that think they know you better than the last arms that held you. Second, how there were so many girls walking from shop to shop, stopping in the doorways with vague, powdered faces. Third, how taking a dress out into the sunlight changes its color and tone. Often it becomes friendlier. Sometimes when I hold your hand, I think, how can you guide the tiller anymore? It feels small and not completely there, the skin thin as onion peel. I remember it being strong and healthy, mother, holding my hand with assurance until I remember that I know nothing about boats. I cannot give the boat builder advice. I can only ask him questions about the wind speed, the drowsiness of being mid-ocean, the snapping of sails, the urgency of sighting land when your barrels have run dry. He frowns at the houses careening on their concrete stilts and says something about clouds how you can't trust them even if you love them. At least they are consistently clouds. Ask about provisions and if hardtack can make salt water taste better. Here where the houses like to live dangerously, someone is building a boat for a river. Someone is building a ship for the sea. I look, but I can only see many blue hills. Gold is spilling down the streets. The women are beautiful and the men are strong. I am sure the children will be angelic singers. Boat building is a child's endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mona Zote. And we will call upon Hannah. Hannah Lalhanpui, who is the author of Blackbirds Fly, and the lectern is yours. Please welcome her with a big clap.
Thank you, BD. Good morning, everyone. And I'm a research scholar here in the department, and on the onset, I'd like to say that the book has been greatly influenced by the faculty members of this department, because after I joined the department in 2017, I've seen and witnessed how the faculty members and the department have been doing a lot in promoting Mizo history and Mizo culture through literature. So my book, When Blackbirds Fly, came out in March this year, and I've been asked to read extracts from the book. For those of you who haven't read the book or haven't bought the book is about the story of a young Mizo boy who narrates his experiences during the bombing of Aizawl in 1966. And the narrative reveals how the tragic incident shatters very personal childhood dreams like riding on a jeep, friendship, and how the protagonist lost his teenage love. And it also tells the story of how the bombing affected family life in the most personal way. And I tried as much as possible to focus on the personal individual sufferings and keep away as much as possible from the political agendas surrounding the insurgency. So I'll read some extract from the book. This is a bit where the protagonist is, as I've said, he's a teenage boy who is still doing his schooling. In the afternoon, in English class, we recited a short poem we had been studying for the past 2 weeks. Japan has been occupied to the center Kohima, very pretty to look at, Ram Ram Sister Onima. We repeated the poem 4 times as the teacher hits the edge of the first row table with his wooden ruler to create a rhythm. The girls in the front row are careful to suppress the R sound while reciting the lines. Since middle school, I have been struggling with the R pronunciation. There was this one time when we were in class 6 when Pilal Ziki came to teach us English. She was and still is the only Mizo lady to have been to London. She entered the classroom and greeted us with a good morning, which was followed by the whispers and giggles. Then she continued asking questions. What is your name? What is your father doing? Which locality are you from? I remember how amused we were that day and the burst of laughter that filled the classroom after Thang Kuma replied in an awkward tone, "My father is a carpenter." That day we went home wondering if all the English words we had ever learned were all spelled wrong. We did not care about Japan or Kohima or Onima. The R had to be silent. And the next bit is after the bombing, the protagonist moved towards the outskirts of Aizawl with a group of people, and that was also what really happened during the bombing. And this bit, which I'm going to read now, is the part where they returned to Aizawl after the bombing, after the air has cleared out. At around noon, around 40 of us leave the bungalow. The pastor leads the group, holding a white cloth knotted at the end of a stick. This is done so in order to let the soldiers know that we are harmless. The walk back home seems much shorter than the onward journey. We stopped for a short rest every now and then. The woman who was breastfeeding her baby is walking behind me and grandfather. The baby had not stopped crying since we left the bungalow. There is not much talking. We walked silently with a faint hope that the people and the things we had left behind would still be safe. There is a gust of wind blowing every now and then as we walk along a few miles before the entrance to the city. The wind carries the ashes of the burnt city in the air, white gray pieces of ash, reminding us of what was and what could have been. I remember the days I used to dream about seeing snowfall. I put out my palm and a weightless lump of ash falls on it. It is not snow, but it feels cold. The city looks burnt out. As we come closer to the city, I notice that we are walking on a mixture of dust and ashes. The road stretches out in gray. My feet look like they have been colored with charcoal. It is almost impossible to make out my toenails. Getting tired of anything black and gray, I glower at the sky with heavy eyes. The sky itself is filled with thick covering of gray clouds that seem to stretch as far as I could see. Is it because of the leftover smoke of the burnt city or a sign of coming rain? I could not tell. The slight breeze grows swifter and begins to throw the ashes in the air, on our faces, sticking to our worn-out clothes like they are mocking us. I can see that grandfather is already exhausted as he grabs my arm tighter with every step. We enter Kulikon in silence. The streets, which were once so familiar, look strange and unwelcoming. The stiff smell of burnt smoke gets thicker with every step. My heart starts to feel heavy as I wonder if father will still be there in the house. I shudder when the thought of him being dead hits my head. Grandfather, as if reading my mind, says softly, "Your father will be happy when he sees us." "I hope he'll be there," I reply in silence. "Thank you."
Thank you, Hana Lilhanpui, author of Blackbirds Fly. And if you haven't got hold of the book, you can buy it and you can read it by yourselves. And like the short readings that we've had, I'm sure it's a very interesting one. So you have to have your own copy for that. Okay, we will move on to Somte Ralte, who is with us. And she is a poet, the author of the book, Wild Hearts. And she's here, she's at the back. So while she comes, let us welcome her with a clap.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you all can see me. Yes, today I'll be reading a prose which is titled Education in Mizo Women. It's been about a year that I have written this piece, and this is the first time that I will be reading it out. And I'm quite nervous because our professors, our lecturers are here, they'll be listening. So, but I want to read this. I have chosen to read this because a lot of what had been taught to us during our MA in our coursework days have been reiterated, and it was actually P.A. Diki who she took our women's writing in our MA days, and there were so many things that she taught us. She inspired us to become better women. And so I wanted to read this, you know, to thank the Department of English for making us become better person that we are today. So let me read Education and Mizo Women. Women's education in Mizoram did not begin as a cakewalk. There are written records that say that when the Welsh missionaries tried to educate women in the southern part of Mizoram in the later part of the 19th century, they were approached by a group of men who asked them to forfeit their plan. And according to the record, it was because the men thought their women should best remain at home and add to the herd. However, the two missionaries, Marjorie Clark and Tracy Chapman, did not budge. They began their work of educating women, and as word spread, women, young and old, attended their day school with much enthusiasm. They were not only taught the alphabets, but were also enlightened in terms of health care, child care, and hygiene. Apart from this, women were also taught basic skills such as baking and sewing as well. Today, most women in Mizoram enjoy equal opportunities of education. In fact, many are doing fairly well. For some years, it has always been a woman who stood first in the matric examinations held under Mizoram Board of School Education. The earlier prejudices against educated women as unsuitable for marriage have undergone tremendous changes over the years. Today, there are many women officers, and it has been said that in most government departments, there are more women directors than men. With such success rate of women in education, how much has education enlightened us as women of the same flock? Education does enlighten and liberate, and many Mizo women are doing quite well. However, in terms of women as a community, it is disheartening to acknowledge the truth that education has not much changed the way we look at ourselves. During committee meetings and other social gatherings, it seems like a modest thing for a woman to say, "For women like us," or "I am but a woman," and the men to say, "Despite her being a woman," as compliment. The main question is, how much has education succeeded in reforming our innate perception of women in Mizo society? To what degree has education brought about changes in our societal construction of the self? We talk of women empowerment and voice against gender issues and write about liberty and equality. But when it comes to voting, we dare not trust our women, our fellow women candidates saying, "What has a woman got to do with politics?" When it comes to a woman being cybercrimed against, we are aghast. We say, "What kind of woman? And we teach our young men to beware of rape victims and divorces because we do not want tainted daughter-in-laws. And we scorn the widows, claiming what we feel are some unlikely, narrow-minded ideas to be of a widow mentality. It is sad to say that despite our education and lofty statuses, we are still in need of lofty mindsets that would stop us from belittling our fellow women. We need to move beyond the mindset that prevents us from achieving what we are capable of. We need to build each other, support each other, not in words alone, but in deeds and in good faith. That would be the true end of education. Because we women shape the future. When we hold the tiny baby in our bosom, we hold the future in our hands. We are responsible for our tomorrow. We need to wake up from our illusionary enlightenment, because if we aren't there for each other, no one will be there for us. I need you, you need me. What if JL had decided not to kill Jabin for killing a woman, for killing a man was not a woman's job? Her name would never be immortalized in the Bible. What if Ruth had decided not to marry Boaz of Bethlehem because she was a widow? She might never be the great-grandmother of our Savior. What if Rahab the prostitute had not helped the two spies because helping such men of God was beyond her profession? She and her family would surely have died when the Israelites attacked Jericho. These women have taught us that sometimes a woman has got to break the mold and do things that are not expected of her. Sometimes a woman needs to rise to the occasion to bring about changes around her, not for herself alone, but for her family, for her nation. Because sometimes the good Lord uses the most unlikely women for his cause. Who knows, the next could be you or your neighbor. With the consideration of how far education has brought us, it is high time that we bring about changes towards women as a community. It's about time that we rise together, form a dialogue and walk the walk, not just talk the talk. We've come this far. Let's build each other up and not tear each other down. Perhaps we're unable to empathize, but perhaps we can learn to sympathize. Perhaps we're unable to relate, but perhaps we can unlearn to retaliate. Perhaps it's impossible to ignore, but perhaps we can learn to tolerate. Education is a lifelong process, they say, and I believe with all my heart that it's not too late to educate ourselves to be a little kinder, a little less judgmental, a little more considerate, and a lot more forgiving towards one another. For what is the benefit of our education if we remain safe in our cocoons, unperturbed by the changes in the world outside? What is the benefit of our education if we allow ourselves to be dictated by the collective prejudices against our own kind? What is the benefit of our education if we do not free ourselves from double standards that we aren't even conscious of inheriting from the construction of our society? We can do so much better because we are capable. Maybe we are weak, but that doesn't mean we are powerless. Together, we can make a bigger difference. Let's begin today. Let's take one step at a time. Thank you.
Such a powerful message from Somde Ralde. I've always known her as a poet, but she is such a motivational writer as well, and continue to do that. And we wish you all the best in whatever plans that you have ahead. And now we will invite Sang Liani. I think she is here. After Sang Liani, please, Kima Miller to be ready. We will be hearing readings from Lydia, Jane, Mary, and Joseph as well. Yes, Sang Liani.
Well, but anyway, a few months back, a friend of mine told me something that she had not shared with anyone before, which was that she was molested by an uncle of hers when she was just a young girl. Though her uncle has passed away, she still has not found closure from the trauma that she underwent and is still going through. And what upsets me most about the conversation that we had is that she seems to be blaming herself for the things that had happened to her. So our conversation got me thinking, and as a result of that, I wrote a little something that I would like to dedicate to everybody who has ever been abused, especially sexually. I hope everybody finds the healing that they deserve. It's called Beautiful Woman, and it goes like this. Beautiful woman, it torments me deep inside to know that I cannot call you by your name, because people would then know of the secret that has been gnawing at your heart for so long. It breaks my heart that yours is a story of a six-year-old girl violated by a man when you should have been protecting her instead. It bothers my conscience to no end, knowing I am a part of a society that imposes silence on victims, silence imposed through prejudices and judgments. We are taught of the dignity of silence, but what good is silence if it does not bring justice? What good is silence if a victim has to live alone with memories that haunt her every day, forcing her to live a life of shame and sense of worthlessness? Sometimes I wonder how different things might have been for you had you spoken out against him. Perhaps you would have found freedom from the clutches of your past. But how were you supposed to know that you did not have to be silent? How were you supposed to know you were not to be touched by a grown man the way you were? And how were you to know no man's hands have the passport to travel across your body without your consent? For me to claim to understand what you have been through would be an injustice to you. I was not there when you were terrorized over and over again. Nobody was there when you felt alone and frightened. Nobody was there to tell you that not all men are like him and that you need not fear all men. But I do wish I have words that could make you accept that what he did to you does not make you all the horrible names you call yourself. You are not defined by what somebody else does to you. Your future is not destroyed. You do not have to let it be. You are not in any way a lesser woman or a human being. You are still the beautiful woman God created you to be, as pure as any woman could be. You can only be defined by the strength, wisdom, and grace with which you face every new day, and for that, you are a beautiful woman. Thank you.
Such a beautiful poem from a beautiful poet. Thank you, Sang Liani. And next up, we invite Kima Miller. Kima Miller, he's there, yes. Let us welcome him.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Today, I will be reading one of my prose writings, which I wrote for my blog. And this piece I actually wrote 2 years ago, back in 2017, when I was 23 years old. And the piece is essentially me, you know, having all the information about life and how I dealt with everything, and just me learning all of the things that I learned up to that point in my life. So the title is called Rambles of a 23-Year-Old, and it goes like this. Stop, I said to myself, as my eyes yet again gleamed over the cute girl in front, who looked no older than 19, blinded by her innocent, mesmerizing gaze and engaging movements that made me want to dance with her under the stars for the entirety of the full moon. Although her sways captured the very essence of my hopeless romantic soul, my heart had to revolt before it became too late, for it knew that the charm was temporary. People get hurt with expectations, and it was an age not sufficient enough to fulfill the role of the committed woman I so deeply desire. Girls like this one still have way too many unconquered city miles left in them before they can find someone to settle down and sip hot coffee with on a little coffee table outside the balcony, holding hands as they stare at the sunset together with the guy of their dreams and the future at their hands. I knew right then that if I don't listen to my heart and turn away, I could again potentially waste some good months of a young girl's life by seeming to want to have fun, yet subconsciously wanting to be in it for a few good years at least, if not a lifetime. It was something I kept imposing on the beautiful souls I've met, keeping their hearts confused with the type of messages I was giving out. The reality of all of it was that that age group was simply not going to cut it when a future spouse was what I was looking for, and I had to look elsewhere to find someone with more personality and willingness, and someone who knew more about life than just Snapchat filters and the romantic life of celebrities. I stopped, grunted a little, and then turned away with my fists clenched. Going home, I knew that even though seeing that girl brightened my day a little, it was going to remind me of a few old affiliations that I made before, whose lives I wish I hadn't wasted, memories I wished could, at this point, go down the gutter and get lost in the abyss. Rainy nights that stared away at bygone auto rickshaws, stars that gave a faint twinkle with every embrace as she climbed up to my arms, and late night TV shows you would wish would show for 30 hours. I would say Netflix and chill, except it wasn't Netflix and we were really just chilling. It pains me to bear these sweet memories knowing that although they were fond, they became obstacles who got in the way of me finding the type of girl I desired for my age, and I had to do something about them. At this point, watching regular old cartoons and wrestling shows in the evening weren't helping anymore, and believe me, I tried. I could not watch a single episode of Ben 10 without falling asleep. I had to look at more mature level of content, and while I liked the show and its humor, I did not necessarily share its philosophy. If only I could find someone who could say the same. They either had to be diehard skeptics or people who don't like the show. Maybe that's one of my problems too. Maybe I'm way too picky and way too selective to have any preferences of my own, lost in a dream world wherein she remains simply a silhouette of what may or may not come. The next event in my list dreaded me too. I, for any reason, do not hate any members of my family, but I knew full well that as soon as I get to the planned family get-together and we sit down for supper after the Lord's Prayer, I would then be immediately showered with praises and compliments from all possible sources like I'm some saint, saying that I'm the perfect example for my cousins to follow, a quintessential nice guy who wears a halo above his head all day as he embodies perfection, albeit all the flaws I have mentioned beforehand, and tons more, which decays my supposed innocence. Maybe I'm safely a mama's boy to them, and maybe I still am, which made them secure. But I am by no means perfect, and the compliments started to feel uncomfortable and undeserved as I aged. What bothered me more was that none of them seemed to look beyond the ideal, and the real me stayed safely tucked inside under his security blanket with no further plans to leave the comfort zone. Everybody had their expectations for my life and what path I'd eventually follow, and I got torn and dissolved between what I want for myself and what others think was the best for me, clashing and fighting against each other for top place in my priority list. I likened myself to Frankenstein's monster, and for a long time I had a head shaped like his. I was made up of parts from different sources of ideologies, dreams and plans from my friends, family and society, all meshed together to form an abomination of a character who simply wanted nothing but to be loved in the end. To be honest, I was left with no choice but to rebel and start following my convictions, or risk ending up becoming a faceless robot to whoever I had to bow down to and live such an uneventful life devoid of excitement and disagreeable situations which would have forced me to use my knowledge to judge what was best for me. This is why I secretly rebel. I like spontaneity, and living in a society which follows a very rigid system in everything we decide to do is not helping. My lack of vocal skills over my peers and to the authorities in charge has disabled me from correctly articulating just how important individuality is in everything we do, whether it's in our faith, Our courage into the ceiling for the rest of the night and ignite the what might have beens and what will really be's. Upon realization of my noticeable maturity as compared to my troubled teenage years and my not so promising commencement for my early 20s, the amount of progress I gained made my heart realize that 23 was not a bad year after all, and became hopeful of a future which might possibly contain a sequence that only existed in my imagination before. That's when my pillow sank in like a marshmallow, when my blanket serenaded a sweet melody as the cool breeze started to fade, and when visions of a future so chaotic and incomprehensible, but nevertheless a future filled with his presence, became stagnant. Life is a hard pill to swallow, but once you do, you get all the necessary nutrients from it and become healthier spiritually and mentally. I was not going to dare miss out on anything the next day and miss out on an opportunity for me to learn. And who knows, by the time I become 30, finally accumulate enough knowledge for me to become a mentor instead of having to learn all the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Elkea Kima Miller. And next up we have Lydia. Lydia is here, I suppose. She is one of the most cheerful research scholars I've ever met. So let us welcome her. And after Lydia, Jane, Mary, to be, please get ready, and Joseph as well. Oh, sorry. Jane, Mary, Joseph.
Good morning, everyone. Today I stand before you with a cold and a pink eye, so I'm very infectious, and I humbly ask you not to stand too near me. I'm a big ball of germs right now. So what I usually write, I don't give them titles because they're most probably ramblings, and I'm only 5 feet. I pretend I'm 5 feet tall, but I'm a very angry little child. So what I write are mostly angry little things. And this is about the place I grew up in, Aizawl. Aizawl is pretty small, if you can find it in the map, like an accidental speck of ink before you start to jot down a sentence. Minutely study a world at class book, your eyes just glaze over. Aizawl, the great invisible homeland of invisible people, but it's there, settled in the great bosom of Daddy Mizoram, its city, the land of tribals and hills, and fresh air and cool water, the land of converted Christians and enforced chivalry and lazy peace, the land of plastic bags and misguided morals and God-fearing politicians, ? Written on invisible brochure, on invisible posters and unseen billboards that was not taught in schools but felt, that was what was set in brittle bones of dry art and sun-stained necks. It was believed every other infant drank doctrine from their mother's breast and defecate sin. That was how it was supposed to be. Eat Genesis for breakfast, lunch with Corinthians and supper with Psalms. On Sundays, lunch was a healthy, special serving of the Book of Revelations, and one had to defecate sin. One had to. Thank you. I'm going to read a short little one. I don't usually write about love, and this is as close to love. It's called Heartbreak. Tonight I muse, sitting stiff in my chair, the computer is on, a catchy pop song on replay. The singer wailing about extravagant goods I will never get to buy. A bug is taunting the light bulb. Its wings buzz as they make love to the light that hypnotizes it. Upstairs, my father's football commentator shouts loudest amidst the roars of cheering fans. My mother turns a page in bed. My sister's phone is active with the soft notification bells, sounds of living, sounds of life. And I sit and sit as slowly she breaks, protected in my body as she is breaking. A shard here, a shard there, without a sound, against the cocoon of sounds, the silent, slow tearing of a little beating heart, art-shattering pain that hides in her silence, the sound of a breaking heart. Thank you.
Well written, Lydia, thank you. And we will call upon Jane Mary Joseph. She's here. And after this, we'll open the lectern for anyone who would like to share their poems or readings, like for two people maybe. Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Now, the short story that I have written here that I'm going to read excerpts from is a very recent one. Actually, very recent, as yesterday. Now, I have titled it Panyan. Now, Panyan is a Malayalam word. It means worker. Now, I have based this story on a tribal community in Kerala. They live in a colony exactly opposite to our house across the road. And they are a people who live till today in close proximity with nature. They are, to a great extent, they are unaffected by what we call modernization. So this is dedicated to all the Panyans who still struggle to gain an equal place with people who consider themselves superior to them. The sound of raindrops trickling down from spaces in the thatched roof woke Chandran from his siesta. The seemingly small drops now formed a puddle in the mud floor of his one-room hut. His wife was in the kitchen, which was merely a small open place in the backyard, preparing delicacies as her brother Chatukuti, fondly called as Chatu, was to join them for dinner. It had become a monthly ritual to have him over at their place. Chandran lay on the bed, still tired. His day was usually spent in the rubber plantations of the neighbors who needed hands at tapping the trees. He worked from 3 in the morning till noon to fend for his family. But the rainy season meant that there was no work at rubber plantations. During monsoon this year, he worked as a farmhand at a rich neighbor's paddy field. Though tired after the day's work, he was looking forward to Chatu's visit when they would once again relive the past. Outside his hut, the fragrance of jasmine flowers and ripe jackfruits filled the air. His children played hopscotch in the front yard with the neighbor's son. Mornings like these reminded him of his childhood days when things were different. Of late, reminiscing the past had become a new pastime of sorts for him. Though belonging to a family riddled with poverty, his childhood was one painted with the most vibrant colors and defined by life in a rich ethnic community. And now, seeing the children so carefree, he could not help but be transported back in time when he was a little boy. Chandran was woken up from his reverie by the voice of his neighbor, Karamben, calling out to him from across the mud path that separated the two houses. "Are you coming over to Angadi? I am leaving." A startled Chandran replied, "No, Karamba, you go ahead. We are expecting Chatu in some time." Nodding, Karamben walked off to the metallic road in front of their colony, across which lived wealthy Nayars and Nasranis. Chandran moved to the kitchen where his wife Shanti was. 15 years of marriage had not changed either of them much. They had known each other since they were 5, but it was a few years before they fell in love during the later part of their teenage years. Both families gave their consent with great joy as they were neighbors who knew each other well. They were a happy family today with 2 children and Chandran's mother Chiruta staying with them. "So are you finally up from your sleep? Can you please help me with roasting the dried ribbon fish? Chatu is very fond of it," asked his wife. Moving to the wooden plank where the sparse groceries were kept, he said, "Yes, make the bhaji too if time permits. He loved it the last time." She smiled, recalling how her brother praised her culinary skills every time he visited them. After dinner, the children gathered around Chatu to listen to tales from the past. This was another practice that was observed without fail every time he paid them a visit. "Tell us about how you were the only one to attend college from your colony." "Yes, I love listening to that story too. Do not miss out on how you were encouraged by Gopan sir to play volleyball," seconded Balan. Chatu had lost count of the number of times he narrated the story but willingly obliged. "Your mother and I were still very young when our father passed away. He too, like many of his friends from the Panyar colony, worked in the farms of rich people in the village. Appa was a very hardworking man, and though poor, we did not know hunger like many amongst us did. But after his death, the onus of the family came on my shoulders." Appu, who had been sitting near the door, moved closer to Chatu and said, "Did Amachi and Amma help you earn a livelihood?" Looking at his sister, who was now in the room after doing the dishes, he responded to the question, "Yes, they did, but..." Every time he reached this part of the story, his voice trailed off. It pained him to even recollect how his mother, sister, and other women from their colony went from house to house begging people for leftovers and alms. Knowing this, Shanti picked it from there.
The women of the colony would form groups and go to the houses of the rich in the village. We would beg for alms from morning, and when it was noon, the villagers at whose houses we were invariably provided us with rice gruel and salt. On some occasions, we were even given a piece or two of dried fish. The villagers were also kind enough to let us walk through their land and collect fallen areca nuts, cashew nuts, and jackfruits. It was a difficult life then, but I am blessed that your father does not let me do that anymore. He works hard to provide enough for the family, but a lot of us do not have it easy even today. At this point, Chatu gained composure and continued with the tale. He spoke of how he grew up without ever attending school in the early years of his life. The community he belonged to was one of forest dwellers who had no inkling of the importance of education. His life of struggles continued till he came across Matthew Sir, for whom he tapped rubber trees. Matthew Sir was a retired school principal who took keen interest in the welfare of children from the Panier colony near his house. What followed this association was a new beginning for Chato. He went on, Matthew Sir was extremely passionate about education. One day I went to collect my wages from him. He said that what a boy my age required was required most was a sound education, and that he was willing to fund mine. He did the same for two other boys from the colony, but they eventually dropped out as the teachers scolded them for not doing their homework. Now I'll skip to the last part of the short story. Before that, he Chatu tries to convince his sister and his brother-in-law as to why they should send their children to the English medium school in town. Chandran, and then he says that they would have to pay donations, but it would be an investment. And the brother-in-law and sister agreed to that. Chandran brought the money to the school office 2 days after his meeting with the principal. He had managed to procure it by taking loan from Krishnan Sir, whom he had worked for before the monsoons, and by selling off 3 gold bangles that belonged to his wife. He handed over the packet with the money to the principal, who directed him to fill the application forms and pay the requisite fees. Thanking him, Chandran left and did as he was instructed. Once he had completed the admission process and before he returned home, he decided to meet the principal once more and thank him for granting his children admission even in the middle of the session. As he approached the office, he heard the principal talking to someone. "Sir, I deserve a greater share this time than on other occasions. You have no idea of how many months I have spent visiting them to convince my sister and her husband." Chandran's face displayed neither shock nor anger. He did not go into the office. Instead, he turned to the entrance and walked home in the scorching sun, memories of a poverty-stricken past flashing before his eyes. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane Mary Joseph, for a wonderful story about education and the importance of education. And I will just invite anyone who would like to read their works from the students, especially anyone, can just raise your hand and come here and read your things. Yes? Okay, there she is. Okay, come here and...
Good afternoon, everyone. I don't know what my writings are. I just call them writings. So here are two of my writings. Okay. You search for a voice you've never heard of. You search for an answer throughout your life, not knowing you already hold the answer to that big question. Maybe you are unaware of who you really are. Imagine breaking down all these thick walls of stereotypical conventions of cultured groups telling you what to do or what not to do. No walls, no conforming to such and such, no rules, simply nothing. Even that is hard for you because, as a matter of fact, you've never ever had even a single thought of that matter because you live there and you may also be the stereotype. You wait and wait for your own Godot, but you realize you're just going in a complete circle. Where, where? An echo in your mind of this big question gets louder and louder until you snap. You search for peace, comfort, tranquility, but the voice, that only voice that you keep searching for in your quest, is what will or what shall give you what you are looking for. But you don't listen. They talk and talk, and then you talk and talk as well, and you just conform, don't you? Plain and simple it is. You're there. You're almost there, almost at the end of the tunnel. But then you fall back to square one. Alone, you shall hear the voice. Alone, you shall crack the codes. Alone, you shall get the answer to your question. All alone, stand alone and listen. Listen close to the voice, that is the answer. And another one. The two are like parallel lines, two lines that do not intersect, two lines that do not cross paths, two lines that will never converge, and two lines that will never meet. Funny how one will never get to defy one's own flesh and blood. The two are inside one vast globe, but 1,000 miles apart, will forever be 1,000 miles apart. Fallen eyelashes, blown out birthday candles, one hand in a clock, and 11-11s were all hopeless hopes. Funny how these two articulate in two languages where one doesn't understand the other and will never get to exchange even a single word. Funny how some say one has the other's features and the most resembling are the dimples. Funny how one smiles in front of the mirror constantly to see one's own dimple, just to get hold of what the other would be like. Funny how A is in between two D and D's. Funny how this word will never make sense. Thank you very much, and a very happy Ruby Jubilee.
Anyone else? Would like to share the lectern? Come on, from the students. Anyone else? Okay. Since we have a lot of students here, I would like to dedicate this poetry that I have. You know, life is a lot of heartaches and heartbreaks, so if you're going through anything like that, this is the poem for you. So it's called December. January fought, February mended, March broke vows, April angered, May cried profusely, June followed, July wanted death, August confused, September missed you, October terribly, and November needed you, December cold. Thank you. Now we shall have, we'll just proceed to the next one. Wait, my program is here. Yesterday once more. So this is the time where we open the lectern to everyone who would like to share. And as the banner is there behind me, we are celebrating the Ruby Jubilee 40 years of our department. So if we have anything to share on the occasion, and also our experiences with our teachers, and also within the classroom, that was fun, right, yesterday? So we will open the lectern again for anyone who would like to come up here and share their thoughts. Okay. Anyone who will take the lead? I don't have anyone to like call upon to take the lead, so who would take the honor? Okay, Sang Yani is here.
Sorry that you have to see me again. I knew that I would get nervous and fumble with my lines, so I've written down the things that I want to share. It was in 2012 that I first got admission into the Department of English as a student of the master program. God has been kind to me, and the place has been my second home ever since, as an MS student, as a research scholar, as a guest teacher, and then as a project fellow.
I think everybody here will be able to imagine how huge a role the department has played in my life in the last 7 years. All of us who are gathered here today know our teachers very well. They have different personalities, different methods of teaching, and different approaches towards different situations in the classrooms. And needless to say, we have all benefited from each teacher. I believe their different approaches have enriched our lives as human beings and as academics. Where one teacher might have a weakness, another teacher will make up for it. And like that, together, they make an amazing, wholesome team. Whether it is P. Maggie imparting precious knowledge to us with a passion and confidence that is unparalleled, or Po Baral challenging us to take our intellectual exercise to a whole new level through his lectures, or MLP ma'am being the epitome of sincerity and efficiency, and as my best friend Lydia puts it, the most efficient human being ever, or Miss Casey's soothing collectedness that can calm even the most stressed of souls, or Miss Laltey's eloquence and expertise as she explores the varied realms of literature, or Dhanajit Sir's apparent enthusiasm to help us discover magic through words, or Miss Christina's fresh and unconventional approach towards education and life itself. All our teachers are uniquely the best of teachers. Now you may wonder why I have not mentioned P.A. Diki. That is because I've been saving her for the last, and not at all because she is the least. Today in 2019, more people are talking about the importance of mental health. But P.A. Diki did just that way back in 2012, when tremendous importance was not yet placed on a person's mental well-being. I remember vividly, as though it were yesterday, P.A. Diki telling us to take care of our mental health and that there should be no stigma attached to mental illness. Back then, we were not used to listening to anybody talk about such matters in such a way. And to this day, I remain grateful to P.A. Diki for telling us just what we needed as a group of young adults who still have so much to go through in life. And congratulations, ma'am, on your professorship. And so it is with confidence, with all the confidence that I have ever felt, that I proudly assert that all of us who have had the privilege to sit in the classrooms of our teachers are blessed, truly blessed. Growing up in the Mizo community, where the church and the YMA are dominant forces, I seldom saw women leaders in the public life. That we have had just about 6 women MLA in the last 47 years since Mizoram became a union territory strengthens the perception that women are usually not seen actively participating as leaders in the public arena. But when I joined as a student at the department, I realized that women can be just as smart as men and just as capable as leaders. But then I also realized that most of our teachers come from progressive families that did not try to clip the wings of their women folk. Not all women in Mizoram can say that of their families. But today, things are better and more women are pursuing their dreams and ambitions and making significant contributions to the Mizo community. And I believe our teachers are pioneers who have paved the way for us younger Mizo women. With the world continuously moving towards creating more spaces and platforms for the sidelined and marginalized members of the world community, our teachers, too, have not failed in teaching us to be proud of our roots, our cultures, and our traditions. And in doing that, they have given us the gift of pride, pride in our history and culture, and that is something nobody could ever take away from us without our will. Through the critical perspectives they have lent us through their lectures, they have also taught us not just to accept things at face value, whether it has to do with our culture or society or even the way we practice our belief system. Our teachers have taught us that it is all right to question the status quo and engage in discourses and debates, and yes, even if we are women. So to conclude this little tribute, I wish to acknowledge God's grace and wisdom in placing me in the hands of people who have so much knowledge and wisdom to share. And I know that it is not just my life that has been touched, but the lives of many others as well. Thank you and God bless you.
Thank you, Sang Liani. And we extend our invite to everyone. Yes, sir. Oh, okay, ladies first.
Yeah, I didn't see you, Sabra. Usually I'm not a very vocal person, but I would like to take this opportunity to give my gratitude to the department. A few minutes ago, Sang Liani has said that she has had a very large experience. I too have had diverse kinds of experiences in the department. I had been a student, I had been a research scholar, I had been a guest lecturer, and now I am a permanent teacher. So I think you can imagine what would be going through my mind as we are celebrating the Ruby Jubilee. Yesterday, I was thinking whether I should stand up or not, but then I felt a bit embarrassed. But now I think it is the time to say thank you to the department, especially to Professor Azama Pimagi, as we call her. She has been there right from the time that I joined the university. She was my teacher, she was my supervisor, and now she is my colleague. And I'm thankful to all the teachers who are there, who have inspired me, who have been an example to me throughout my life. I've spent many years of my life in the university, and I'm glad to say that they have molded me and they have made me to be the person that I am. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone, and especially our senior colleague, Professor Jama, and all our colleagues. And I will also express my gratitude to the invited friends, poets, creative writers, and writers, and our friends and scholars. I often say that my students are my student friends. So with that view in my mind, I often treat them. No doubt I challenge them to stand up and speak their mind, but they never do. Even yesterday, my name was referred to in various ways. I felt as if I was an unknowing fool during my class hours. I am not. Actually, what happens is that my experience in my student time was slightly different from yours, maybe. We are all structured by our past experiences, right? Because we are groomed from our childhood, even during the school time and so on. So my teachers always gave us the freedom to move out of the class during the class hours without disturbing others as well as the teachers focused on teaching. So that way, I might have appropriated that attitude. I always respected that students should not sit down in the classroom tightly, tight-legged, and tight-bodied every time. If they have some kind of a pressure, maybe mental or physical, they must move out through the back door, without disturbing others. coming to the front door and saying, sir, I want to go. Then coming from the outside, sir, I want to come in. So that way it disturbs the teacher also. Because the teacher is out there to contribute his or her best. So I don't want to get disturbed. That way, that was how a little difference in our maybe structured, traditions. So that is the difference, otherwise not. But one very important and interesting thing happened that Professor Margaret Pachuau, our present HOD, referred to the students buying, slipping out of the class and buying guava. I didn't remember that. It is so interesting. If nowadays you people try to, slip out of the class, I will ask you whether you are going to buy a guava or apple for me. So this is out of the joke. Actually, I wanted to share my limited knowledge with my friends, students, so that some kind of their doubts would not remain. Whatever I was given to, deliver in the syllabus. So that was the only focus. Secondly, I will come to the other part that I am really amazed, talking from the very, felt experience for 2 days, that our department has produced so many wonderful souls, not only poets, not only creative writers, not only, thinkers, but even wonderful singers. Oh, wow. Even, I will give a big clap to the singers. They have the wonderful voice. Today, I was so amazed. Well, Amteya, I know him already. What about others, the budding singers? That's really good, amazing. So if our students, not because in many fields our students have found out into many many ways of doing their job, doing their life, and so on. But here at least we could find that our students have really contributed colorfully to the name and fame and the grandeur of this department. I no need to mention our established renowned poet Mona Jote, but besides, she may be looking quite young, but she is the grand lady, I would say. I would express my gratitude, sincere gratitude to all of you, all the creative souls, and those who are coming up. And I wonder whether after 10 years, we might be celebrating the golden Jubilee, whether you will be here around. And that would be quite nice if we meet. But by that time, like Professor Jama, I will be also retiring by that time. So anyway, so keep up. It's not merely the academic learning alone, fulfills our soul yearning. About one thing I will here recall that most of our colleagues are here, but some unfortunately have departed from amongst us. I will recall their name, like Dr. Ramte, and Dr. Ganguly, and someone like Dr. Biswas, who has already joined another university. And Professor Baral has retired. So along with our colleagues, we all recall and recognize that they were and they will remain. An inseparable part of our mental education. Mental education in the sense not individually, but they have contributed to the collective collective identity of this department, we must also recall, remember their names and their contributions. So the last thing I would say, when I came and joined here, Mizoram University in 2005, it was a little interesting experience for me in a different place, and to be very frank, a little culturally different place. So, but at that time, I was enjoying the green. What should I say? The green, the richness of the green around. Because in our place, in my place, in the mainstream, usually you won't find so much of a greenery, and that was quite appeasing to some way my drying mind or drying soul. So that's all okay, and I'm thankful to nature's richness. You might say God's richness here. But at the same time, I am actually grateful to the collective consciousness, or one can say self-unconsciousness or unself-consciousness of the community, which has found itself living pleasantly in communion with nature. So I think most of you who are living within the rich verdure around you, you must produce good and great poems and writings of your experience, because we don't have them out there in our dry mainland and other places, okay? So you need to be aware of nature's contribution to your life. And besides, it has Aizawl, and around Mizoram has a blissful greenery, and it has really enchanted and enriched our life. So with these words, I would say the last word, like, I am not only grateful to our department, to all my colleagues and to all my students, but also to the organizers of this Jubilee celebration. Thank you all. God bless you.
Thank you, sir. And we would still open the lectern. Amteya is here.
Good afternoon, everyone. I always try to convince myself that I'm not a speaker, but whenever I start, I usually don't know how to stop. But I jot down points to guide me here, or rather to stop me. Yeah, I am here representing the batch which the teacher labeled as the first batch to ever start mass bunking culture. And, looking around, I guess that is still standing true, because I don't see any of my batchmates here. Anyway, I am so glad that I chose and am chosen to be a part of this department, as I have learned a lot about life and more so about myself as a human being. The knowledge that I gained here has helped me immensely as a performer and also as a songwriter, and also the philosophy and the ideology that I have about life. You know, this day, well, this Jubilee brings back a lot of memories. Even coming up to this place, seeing the old department building and the roads that we used to walk on with my friends, reminds me of the friends that we've lost, the friends that have passed away. And it brings back a lot of memory, the joy and the hardships that we used to share together. And, there were hard times, sad moments and joys also, but the good and the bad memories that I have are like puzzle pieces that helps make this man that is standing in front of you. And I am thankful to the department, to my friends, and to the incomparable teachers that we have today. You know, being a rebel and being a defiant person who, you know, who failed to accept things easily, these teachers that I have has helped me hone that trait that I have and steer me to a direction which makes me more useful to the society, and I thank you today. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Omdia. We still have time before lunch, so anyone who would like to come up and share? Yes, Jane is there.
Good afternoon once again. Now, the things that I'm going to say here are very personal to me. Now, I have been associated with this department from 2015 when I joined as a postgraduate student. And the 2 years that I spent as a postgraduate student, I did not have any experiences of discrimination. Now, the reason that I say this, it would look very weird that we talk of this in this day and age, but then it happens a lot, and I'm aware of it, especially when I talk to friends who are studying outside the state. You know, there are a lot of people who discriminate, even the faculty. So I personally have never had such an experience, and that is something that I value a lot. And I want to thank all my faculty, all my teachers for, you know, considering me as their own throughout, even then and till today. And the second thing that I want to share is my writing has, I believe, grown over the past 4 years. I started writing poetry when I was in college. Till the 12th, I took science. I would never even imagine writing anything beyond an essay or an article, you know, or a creative writing. And when I was in college, our HOD in Shangbana, Ma'am Zomhingi, she just put in my name for a poetry competition, and I said, but ma'am, I've never written a poem in my entire life. And she told me that, no, you can do it, and she pushed me, but I did not win any prize in that competition. And today when I look back at that poem, I'm like, oh my God, what did I even write? And I still remember even till the third, fourth semester when I was here, I remember Ma'am Sherry calling me to her office one day and telling me that I write in a very matter-of-fact manner. And she told me to be a little more creative if I intended to carry on with creative writing. And I really worked on that. And I'm proud to say that last year, I won the second prize at the national level for the Wingwood Poetry Prize. And I started writing short stories in the fourth semester, I think, when Ma'am Zama was taking our Narratives of Northeast. And I still remember she was not just dealing with the story itself. She was telling us what are the essential characteristics of a short story, how a short story is written. And every time I write a short story, I remember this phrase, the twist in the tale. You know, she would talk about that all the time. And even yesterday when I was writing about this short story that I just read out, I was trying to bring in that twist. And I remember the first short story that I wrote, when I remember this twist in the tale, I had such a tough time bringing in the twist and I didn't know what to do. I ended up mercilessly driving the protagonist to commit suicide. And and the last thing, I am very much touched by the kindness I have seen in my teachers during these past 4 years. I'm a person who has a lot of health problems. I'm wearing contact lenses right now. I actually have a high myopia of -22.5. I have really thick glasses and I have a lot of trouble because of that. Now, when I joined, Professor Baral was the HOD, and I had told him about this problem that I have. And I still remember in the second semester, he came into the class and, you know, it was very funny and we really laughed at that point. But now when I look back at it, he was so kind to me, you know. He came into the class with this register on the first day and he asked, who has good hands? Because he wanted someone to write, fill in the names in the register. So my classmate said, Jane. And then Professor Baral was like, no, I cannot let her write it because she has good hands, but she has very bad eyes. And then I said, but sir, I can write it. And then he was like, are you sure you can write? will it not strain your eyes? And at that point, it looked so funny and we laughed a lot. But then when I look back, he was so kind. And before I end, there is one person, a very, very special person whom I want to thank here. And she's sitting right at the back there, Miss Christina. The reason is because I have been suffering from anxiety, OCD, depression, a lot of this from right from the 11th standard. And last year in December, my anxiety had just shot up. And it was during the holidays and I was not even here. I happened to discuss something about poetry with Miss Christina over text messages. And then I told her about this. And she told me to meet a therapist. And I had been to a lot of psychiatrists, they did not help. I had actually given up. And she not just advised me to go to a therapist, she also actually called up a therapist, got me an appointment and told me to go visit her. So, ma'am, I cannot thank you enough. I am not completely all right. I'm still struggling, but I'm a lot better today. So thank you for that. So with that, I end what I have to say. Thank you.
So is there Lang Hun Kanla Neya? Anyone else? Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Zir Sang Lena, and I'm the class assistant representative for third semester. So I'm standing here on behalf of my classmates. And you know, I actually thought of bailing out from this moment because I don't think I would have the courage to stand out here. But then I had a change of heart because I don't think I will be able to forgive myself if I miss the opportunity to come out here on this very special and auspicious day. And just to lighten the mood a bit, I think I should talk about my first impression of our professors here. And you know, when I say I'm not only talking about myself, it is a collective impression. I'm not here to roast you, okay, or to embarrass you. I'm just here to give you a glimpse into our world, you know. And as much as you put your time and effort to, you know, kind of study our behavior and know ourselves, know your students, we also do the same every day. Okay, we put in a lot of effort into the kind of dress you wear, the color of your tops, your skirts, and your behavior. So I'm not going to talk about that. And well, who should I start with? I'll start with Sir Dhanajit. Where is him? Okay. Sir Dhanajit is the most active professor. Okay. And the amount of energy that he exudes in his during his lecture in his class sometimes makes me wonder his true identity. Maybe, just maybe, he's actually a 17-year-old boy trapped inside an older man's body. I'm not sure. That's the kind of person he is. And also Sir Baral. One thing that we noticed, it's not just me, is that whenever Sir Baral enters the classroom, we always look at his facial expressions, you know, his head movements. That is a different, that is a kind of, you know, a different world. That is high fashion stuff. Okay, you cannot simply recreate the way he moves his head. It's just that powerful. And also, Sir Baral has a special talent, and his talent is that he never runs out of words. Give him an hour or two more, give him 4 hours more, give him a day more, he will not run out of words. That is his talent, okay? And of course, our very own HOD. I have kind of a, you know, strained relationship with our HOD because she is the first professor to scold me in this university. And the worst part is that she scolded me on the very first day. So I was kind of scared of her for 2 semesters, the first and the second semester. But now that I'm the class assistant representative, I get to know her more. And you know, I think we're on a good terms now. And for our juniors, I would like to give a cautionary warning. Okay, if you don't want to end up on the, you know, bad side of our HOD, what you have to do is don't be late, don't procrastinate, and do your work and do it perfectly, and then you will be good student. Okay, and Miss Casey. Miss Casey is like the most chill, okay, of all our professors. You will not see her running around, not because she's lazy or anything, but just because she's that chill. There are no words to describe it, okay? So there's this saying, okay, I'm not sure if our teachers will know this, but Miss Casey did not choose the thug life. The thug life chose her, okay? She's that chill. Okay, who else? Okay, Professor Margaret Tozama. Okay, we have heard of her name because actually one of her translations was in our, you know, BA course, the translation of Ting Pui. And Professor Tozama, she has this star power, okay? Ngai sang o varang tika. But sometimes I think that kind of gets in the way of, you know, our lecture, because instead of listening to our lecture, most of the time we spend looking at her dress, the way she talks, her accent and everything. So effective low pave and also she's the kind of person that everyone wants to have as a mother, that is for sure. And in fact, one of her classmates, she never refers to Professor Zama as professor. She always calls her mom, my mom, and Miss Christina as her sister. Kanutlas, kaunaunutlas. She used to say that. Okay. And also, who else? Ma'am Rindigi. Okay. Ma'am Rindigi, her voice alone is an antidepressant. Okay. You can go into the class feeling, you know, whatever you're feeling out inside, but the moment she talks, you immediately calm down. So that is her talent. And also she has killer eyes, okay? Have you ever looked at her directly in the eyes? Because I have. And what happened when you look Ma'am Rindik into her eyes is that you will be captivated. There is no escape. It will stuck there forever until the end of the class, okay? And Miss Christina. Miss Christina is one thing that I really, really admire about Miss Christina is that she is very open and always ready to listen to us. You know, we are still students, we are not perfect. And when she asks for our interpretations during her class, no matter what you said, she always listens to us with interest. And so thank you so much for that. And I think I've covered all our professors, I think. Okay, and as a closure, I would like to thank our professors for the time and effort that they put into us and their, you know, how would I say this? Oh, me puit ling kan ni loan lao vanga kan tana. Thank
you. Yes, Miss Mona Zote.
I'll just pick up from where Sang Liani left off. She was talking in great depth about the department and the teachers. So I was here, actually the department was still under Nehu when I joined. And I think it was just on the year that we graduated that it converted into MZU, the Mizoram University. And from there, Professor Zama, Professor Margaret Pachwal, and Miss Casey, Professor Casey, are the three who remain from that original faculty. Piramte, Dr. Ramte, quite unfortunately passed away. And there was Balsom Kima, we used to call him Sir Musky. And I always thought his name was Musky, and I was wondering what kind of a name was that. Please don't tell him. So anyway, we used to be there. The classrooms were there, Tsar Mari, you know the road, Kualto Ukha. I think there's Lois Bett printing office over there, printing shop over there. And just next to it, so it was below stairs, below the road, and it was pretty dark, and there were only about 20, I think less than 20 of us in one batch, our batch. And we were quite okay. I don't think we were very wild or anything, but I do remember one day that P. Maggie was taking class, and she was going on as usual, and there was suddenly a... You know, there was this one of our classmates, Ming Tea Kanti Mei. He always sat at the back. He was a backbencher, typical backbencher. And on that day, he was sitting at the back, and P. Maggie was taking the class, and suddenly there was a very loud thump, and the whole building shook. And this Ming Tea, who's sitting at the back, you know, the sound had just finished and he was already out the front door, and P. Maggie was just turning, and we were all looking at each other wondering what the sound was. It was actually the water tanky that had fallen on its side. And we still think about that and laugh, because, you know, among he was there and then 1 second and the next he was through the door. And we told him, my goodness, so much for ladies first. You know, if you're going to have a real disaster, you'd not even stick around to rescue any of us. So there's quite a lot of little things that you remember back then. And I wouldn't dare to come and give impressions of any of our venerable teachers at that time. So we'll skip over that part. But the other thing, and I just want to, again, just talk about... Professors Zama and Patwao in particular, because that was when they were translating for Katha all those short stories, and I think that was the first project that had ever been made on translations. And I used to go because it was part of the whole Northeast writers thing. We went to Itanagar once. We went, I think, a couple of times to Guwahati, and they were very memorable trips. I learned a lot from them. I also learned some yoga from Professor Zama. I think both of us did. In fact, that was when, ma'am, you were very much into yoga and you were showing us some of the moves. Yes, we just wanted to sleep and you were insistent on showing us how you do the animal walk, for instance. I remember that. So there's a lot of things to be said about it. But what I want to pick up from where Sang Liane was talking is that you have... And the gentlemen in the faculty will excuse me, I hope, but you have some of the most formidable women in Mizoram here in this department. And this is something that I have noticed because I'm in the government. We meet a lot of officers and so on. So I have to say that in the English department, MZ, you have absolutely amazing ladies, your teachers. And this is not to say that the gentlemen are not bad or anything, but I want to point that out, because so much of what we heard today was focused on women in particular. So while you're here, learn from them as much as you can, because you look back and when we were studying, we were kind of just 50% focused on our studies. But the thing is that, they have very unforgettable personalities, and that kind of shapes you. When you see people like this, it impresses you. It leaves an impression on you for the rest of your life. And I think this is really important. That you have some of the best people that you could possibly find in Mizoram. I'm not joking, in Mizoram, not just Aizawl. So I would like to wish all of the students and the faculty once again
a very happy Ruby Jubilee. It's great to be here, and I'm looking forward to lunch at this point. I hope it's going to be good. So thank you. And by the way, there was some really good singing. Some of them was not that great, but some of them was pretty good. So I hope that I am in agreement with the judges later on. So, and if you pick somebody who's not my favorite among the singers, I'm going to protest. Okay, thank you so much.
Being the Department of English, I was worried that we won't have enough speakers for this moment because we've already had 3 sessions yesterday, but this is the Department of English. This is what we do, we share, and we are like a family. So we'll close the program, the first session of today, and I got a report that lunch is ready. This is for all of us, so we will eat to our full. And after that, we will come back at 3 p.m. and we will have the prize distribution for 3 categories: poetry, short story, and musicals. And then we will have, that's the pretty much about the second session. So right now, we will go there and have lunch. Thank you, everyone, for your time. We'll start our second session again, and today, this afternoon, we have the Dean School of Education, Professor Esker Sharma. We welcome you, and he is going to give away our prizes. And the first category, as I've mentioned earlier, is in the category of poetry, and the second one is short story, and the third one is musicals. In the category of poetry, we have a very respectable judge, who is none other than Mona Zote. So I would like to invite Mona Zote to clarify about this judgment and also to comment on the entries and also, whatever necessary. Yes, Mona Zote.
So a few words before we ask the dean to come up and distribute the prizes. There were 6 entries for the category of poetry writing, and out of that, of course, 3 were chosen. I selected 3, and as we distribute the prizes, I'll be starting from the 3rd prize and going on to the 2nd and the 1st, and I will briefly say exactly on the criterion on which they were judged to be deserving of the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd prizes. And as said before, there were 6 entries, and this was completely blind. I had no idea that I was going to be judging, in fact, until I was told that I would be doing that. So, and no idea about who wrote them, and frankly speaking, I don't really know anyone from the semesters anyway. And so, at risk of life and limb, I was requested to judge, so I did. So if, I'll begin with the 3rd prize. The 3rd prize goes to the poem entitled The Ginger Man, and this was selected for its unusual and arresting image of the old man in the poem as the focus, which also conveys a deeply spiritual message. So the 3rd prize winner, the writer of the poem.
Ms. Mona Zote, yes. The Dean School of Education is here, so he will be giving away on your behalf. So, Professor S.K. Sharma, kindly to the front. This is the 3rd prize. Yes.
This is the 3rd prize. Writer of the poem, The Ginger Man. Oh. Yes, I'm so sorry. I should have mentioned that I don't have the names of the writers over here, just the names, the titles of the poems.
Okay, on to the second prize. The second prize goes to the poem entitled Winter Sky, which was found to be a spare and pithy poem that managed to distill a sense of winter's brittle beauty through its brevity. So Winter Sky, writer of Winter Sky, gets the second prize. Okay. And first, last but not least, the first prize. This is the poem entitled Grandma Sari. Its clarity of language and imagery and its compassionate evocation of the subject, both of the grandmother as well as the sari, earns it the first position. So please, the writer of Grandma Sari.
Yes, thank you, Professor S.K. Sharma and Ms. Mona Zote. That was in the category of poetry, and I don't quite catch your name, but the first prize winner was Jane Mary Joseph with her poem, Grandma Sari. So this is to gently request you that you will be reading out that poem, if you have that. Yes, after some time, okay? Okay, now we will call upon Ms. Hana Lalanpuyi. This will be in the category of short story, and she will be telling us the criteria of that, followed by the prize distribution.
Hello, everyone. First, I'd like to say that I was very surprised with the level of talent that I came across in the submitted works. And some of the writings are the best ones that I've read in written by a Mizo writer in English. And before I declare the result, I'd like to say that in particular, the winning story, the first prize winner, was so captivating that I had to reread it 4 to 5 times, and the story stuck with me for days. And after I've submitted the result to our head, I read it out loud to my siblings, and my brother said that he couldn't sleep that night because the story was so gripping. It was that good. And we have a total of 8 entries in this category, and the judging was based on a manual point system divided into 3 categories, content, narration, and mechanics, where each category carries points on a scale of 1 to 10. And the points scored by the winner came to a total of 23.5, the second to 22.5, and the third prize winner to 22. So we can see the difference in point is very minimal, and it was really difficult to choose the best. And I'd also like to add that the judging was very fair, and it was a blind judging, just like the poetry, and we do not know the names of the people who wrote these stories. So I'd like to call out our respected dean to give away the prizes again. The third prize-winning story is a powerful piece of writing that deals with the female plight, gender issues in a very relatable manner. The story is titled Barely Breeding, and it goes to Ms. Lalwat Kimi. And the second prize-winning story is a hilarious account of the life and character of a single guy called Thong Sem, while putting forth interesting philosophical questions and issues. And the winner of this second prize is On Pins and Needles by Lel Ram Eng Mo Yak Heng Lot. And
And the first prize-winning story, like I've said, is a gripping story that tells of a terrifying boyhood experience that continued to affect the growing up years of a boy, which is the protagonist. And like I said, it is a very gripping story, and I hope everyone will get to read it later. The winner of the short story writing competition is the story titled The Year by Lirim Ratasailau. Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you, both of you.
Congratulations to all the prize winners, and we are hoping to get a readout of a snippet from the Delior by Lirim Ratasailau, if it's possible. Yes. Yeah. And now we will proceed to the musicals, and I call upon Dr. Henry Lalmoy Zwala, Assistant Professor of Patungay University, to give away the prize, to announce the prize.
Good evening, everyone. Kohit at whom bulbul may tailo and just don't wait on them. Yes, unlike the other two categories that we have just witnessed, I mean being distributed, this was actually done today, and it was judged on the spot. And I was not very surprised, actually, but somehow I admire the people who came and sang. So one thing that I would like to say over here is that we did not have any particular criteria as to like, okay, this is a formal singing competition and therefore we'll be judging you on this particular criteria and all. Because if we had been doing that, it would have made the contestants very nervous also. And as such, we didn't have much contestants for the particular singing competition, and therefore it was fairly easy on our part. I would just like to mention that there are two other people judging with me on this particular competition, so Am Tele Nu Nui. So if you can just kindly rise from your stand from your seat, yeah. So it's a collective effort that I'm just going to announce over here. So once again, what I would like to say is that singing and songs and music is very much related to literature. And especially regarding me, my supervisor, ma'am, will be able to tell you a lot about regarding me and my career in, sorry, not career, but my indulgence in music also. So it has always influenced me into learning literature better. So I always try to encourage students also that music is one way of entering the realm of literature, because it is something that is always connected. And especially in the field of poetry, it is something which is very much, not that it is the same, but then I think somehow the muses are connected. That is the muses of poetry and the muses of music. So I would like to encourage the students over here today also that music is always a very, very interesting, thing that you can go into if you want to explore more about whatever kinds of literature that is there in front of you. Anyway, having said that, we had only two contestants. I mean, it was a group effort, and therefore, even though three persons were singing, we had to judge it on the basis of the first semester and the third semester. So it was fairly easy on our part. So, Lirim Ratasailau tifer lo de ulega zai pani kan ron de ya amaro chu engpon ise. I will just go ahead and announce the prizes, and I would like to request the respected dean to kindly come and distribute the prizes once again. So I'll just start off with the first prize, okay? And some of you might feel that the entire competition is rigged once I announce this prize. Because the first prize goes to the third semester, Lirim Ratasailau, and Ramwan Omi. Where is Ramwan Omi? Omvel Omi. Level up. Oh. Yes. And obviously the second prize goes to the first semester. Lalram Ruatah Maran, Vanlal Fakanamte. Just wait, yeah. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes, thank you, Sir Henry. And now we will call on Jane Mary Joseph to read her poetry, her poem. It's called Grandma's Sari. And I would like to call after this Michelle Ropui, the third semester, for her number. Yes, let us welcome Jane.
Good afternoon, everyone. Now, I'm really taken by surprise that I won a prize for this because I submitted it on the last day, on August 31st, and I wrote this on my way to the university in the bus. Okay, so the title of the poem is Grandma's Sari. The old, faded, tattered six-yard length of cloth brings back a flood of memories, not of being wrapped around a swelled figure, not of expensive royal silk, not of lavish parties, but of covering a frail lady with begrimed limbs, of hours spent working in the fields under the scorching sun, of sparse meals cooked by the flickering light of the lamp. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane Mary Joseph. And now we shall lend our ears to Michelle Ropui, who is currently studying the third semester of this department.
Shadows and the stars appear, and then
you. Make you feel my love. Michelle Ropui, thank you so much. And now I invite Lalram Ruata Silo to read out his story, short story. And after this, we'll call upon Mr. Amtea, who is here with us.
Okay, well, I'm very surprised that this thing can even get me this far. So, well, the story, like the title, it's a very grotesque topic, but, well, to put it simply, the story is about these local boys just playing in the woods like boys would usually do, and they would make bows and arrows and pretend to go hunting in the evening and on every Sunday. So the story starts where the character is playing with his friends one particular evening, and there he finds something which will totally change his life. So I'm going to read a small paragraph here. The part where he found the human ear. So here goes. I begin to pull the string of my trusted bow and focus on my target instead. I even held my breath to aim more precisely, and once I knew I was ready, I let go of the string and off went the arrow. It flew swiftly and very straight, but missed beautifully and went directly beneath the bamboo tree and into the leaves, and the bush cricket flew away. I was disappointed. I watched the little lucky creature as he flew away, and then I realized I had lost my arrow. I beat my way among the bushes with my bow, and my mobility was very poor as the place was very thick with leaves. Once I reached the spot I knew where my arrow fell, I began to dig the leaves with my bare hands. Leaves after leaves, I kept on digging, and it felt like trying to dig through water as the leaves would come back again and again. After a few seconds of digging, I managed to reach the ground, but still could not find the arrow. I was troubled deep down. If I lost the arrow, I would be kicked out of this group and would be an outcast for about a week. But as I kept on digging, I noticed something strange, something pale. And first I thought it was a dead lizard, but could not exactly make out what it was. It was covered with small black ants, and as I looked closer, it began to take shape. First, I could not believe my eyes, and in total shock, I picked it up and looked even closer. I could even smell the scent as it was so close to my face. It was an ear, a human ear. It had small traces of blood still left to where the cut would happen, and as I inspected it closely, it was definitely cut with a sharp object. I looked on the ground to where I stood and checked to see if there was blood on the ground, but everything seemed to be clean, just a solid brown ground with dry leaves and no traces of blood. I blinked hard and even looked harder to prove to myself that it was not a human ear. Even if it was a real ear, I would rather want it to be a pig's ear or a dog's ear, but I was old enough to tell what was human and what was not. Should I scream or shout? Should I call for the eldest and the others? What if it was not a human ear, but rather just another piece of thrown away meat? I looked around and checked the other children, and they all seemed to mind their own business and were happy hunting. I was lost, shocked, and disturbed by the discovery that I just made, and the smell would call me back as if it wanted my attention, and it smelled salty. I was holding it up with my left hand and felt that it was cold. I gave it a squeeze and with my fingers, and it felt soft and solid. It was the left ear of a person. Thank you.
Okay, that was very intriguing. Thank you, Lalram Ruata Silo. The question is, whose left ear was that? So we wish to hear the rest of it, but it's all the time that we can give for right now. So for all the prize winners, I again encourage you to write more and play with your creativity more. And now we shall call upon Amtea. Amtea, Silarin Zuala.
Good afternoon, everyone. At this moment, I would like to request the second prize winner in the musicals, the first semester, to play me a song, because I chose three songs, out of which two have already been sung, Imagine and Make You Feel My Love. So I just sing this beautiful song, which is Let It Be by the Beatles. Yeah. Myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be.
For Aptea and our very talented musicians, the first semester musicians, thank you. And now we have one more item left in our program, that is a solo performance from Nunui. But I think Nunui has something, a surprise for us, so I'll just call upon her and she will give us the surprise.
My surprises. Sir Henry is going to play me the piano. Please come. Please give a round of applause for him. I plan on singing another song, but we changed. So I thank you in advance. So I'll be singing How Great Thou Art.
And Sir Henry, I was hoping that I would make a request, Sir Henry, to sing, but he says that, quote unquote, I don't sing, I make people sing. So he makes Nunui sing. So that was a very good collaboration. Thank you, both of you. And this is also not in the program, but I would like to call upon Professor S.D. Baral to kindly step up to the lectern. Yes, he's going to take a few moments.
Actually, if I start singing, you will all run away from this room. I will not bore you with that. Actually, I forgot to mention one particular interesting, interesting input from one of my student friend. But before that, I will request all the music lovers, especially persons like Dr. Henry, that wherever they find some chance to inspire, to introduce, to bring into light all our budding singers, they should do. Even without my saying and requesting, they will do that. Because had I been nominated as selector, what a crisis I would have created, because everything, is hard, so sweet, so fascinating to me. So thank God that I am not
selector of the good singers. But however, our singers, our student friends and singers, they are perfectly justified in being put into limelight and in different videos or in social groups or whatever government sponsored programs, they should be encouraged. Whenever time comes, I think I request all of you to lay your good hands towards that. So the last one thing I want to share with you is this. This is a kind of knowledge male exactly earns. What is that? When I only came into this department, I found a little strange activity inside the classroom. I want to share with you that. I found most of our girl students will be chatting with themselves even before or in the presence of the teacher. I was wondering, year after year, I was wondering what happens to me. Because I found them, they are not, you know, sitting quietly or listening quietly. In between the class, they will be starting talking and smiling and all that. I was wondering, I could not share with my young colleagues also. What is the reason? There must be something wrong with me. My way of delivery or whatever, or a new man, you know, kind of that. So in one batch, actually, I could bravely put this question to the talking girls. And she was, I found, especially I found her very talkative. Even, you know, during my serious discussion. She's very much around here. She's quite a good student, no doubt about it. Then I said, why do you feel like talking when I am, you know, discussing certain serious topic and all that? Why most of you are talking during my classroom? Do you dare to talk like this or disturb like this in the presence of Professor Jama? I mentioned that. Then everybody kept silent. Then I said, no, I really want to know. Because I had no experience of that. Because year after year, batch after batch, I found that similar kind of little less pleasant experience, even though I went with my discussion. Then she came up saying, sitting, and I said, you feel free, you talk to me. What is that thing? Then she replied, talking among the girls, sir, this is the girl thing. I couldn't really realize what she is saying. Please repeat. She said, this is a girl thing. So this is a kind of, one can say this is a silly or mischievous, but I found it is quite intelligent. Of course, perhaps a male one cannot understand what is the girl thing. To talk freely, to share something maybe interesting or uninteresting among themselves. Then since that time, since that day, I did not bother. I enjoyed, well, let them talk. And they were free, and they were not disturbing me. They were not disturbing my talk. And the girl's name, would you like to hear? Our Sangliani. Sangliani. So this is the quite, you know, don't think the students, you might be cracking jokes behind us, but we also study you sometimes without your knowing. So do a little bit of that joking, even in our presence sometimes, but you are also intelligent. I found this is really an intelligent thing. Maybe it is mischievous, I don't know, but I learned something. About, you know, if you don't take it in a bad light, about female tendency to speak. And she could really gather that courage to say, sir, this is the girl thing. thank you all of you.
Thank you, Professor S.D. Baral. We have come to the end of our program. I would like to open the lectern for our faculties here. If there is anything you would like to share, Professor Zama? Yes?
I'll be very, very brief. I welcome our dean of our school. In fact, I think you are the only one who is not part of the Department of English here today, but you are very much the dean of our school, so you're part of our family. Just a few words. Today has been such a wonderful day. I don't know how to put it. Really, I don't. My only regret is, I wish we had the same crowd that we had yesterday, because it would be so wonderful for us, your teachers, for others to see the kind of products that have come out from our department and the kind of students we have today as well. Katitaktak nuam anivo inhi. And it has really opened my eyes to many things, even to myself as a teacher, certain things which, you know, I may not have given thought to because one is busy trying to finish the course and getting on with the work as such. So sometimes I guess I also tended to forget that maybe I was dealing with, you know, people who had their kind of their own perspectives and outlook and feelings and emotions in the class. Anyway, Pubaral just now, I think what he did was a kind of a tit for tat. So kudos to him. Huh? Today we have heard so many interesting things, first of all, about teachers, you know, your reminiscences, and even from our current students. Nobody is going to get less marks for the kind of irreverent comments and shocking revelations we heard today from the representative of the third semester, without mentioning names. It's really nice that we get to see ourselves from another perspective, how our students see us. There is something so diplomatic in calling Miss Casey the most chilled out person, you know, chilled out. It really covers so many things about her. Really nice. So our students are so diplomatic and clever and intelligent, it seems, you know. They see so much of us. What I want to say here is we listen to readings. You know, sir, in the morning you were not here. We listened to poetry, original writings, you know, and they were actually read by the poets themselves, people who have passed through our portals, as it were. Then also stories, short stories, and bits from novels that they have written. And as a teacher of literature, although I won't say I have read very, very widely, I won't claim, but I have read a lot. And I can tell you, this is also by way of motivating those who have potential and those who are already on the way. I tell you, your choice of theme, subject matter, the manner in which you present what you want to say, is in no way inferior. In fact, I would say, in many ways, I find at this age, what you are doing, I find it so excellent and superior. And I think that is something y'all should take seriously, because collectively, you know, as the faculty here, I think it comes from us, from the kind of experience we have had with literature, the fact that we find out that we have such talent that, you know, that is going out from us. That is one thing I want to say. And of course, Pubaral has been so fascinated by the singing. So since he has so many things about the singing and the singers, I won't add to it. But Another thing I want to say before I call it a day for myself is, you know, I kind of dropped a hint yesterday. Our department, being 40 years old, it's but natural also that we have had, you know, thousands of students who have passed through our portals. But I tell you, today if you go to the hospital, if you go anywhere to the banks, to the offices, to the colleges, to the schools, politicians, and business houses, those who form the backbone of Mizo society today, I can tell you, many, many of them are from our department. Like, you know, Pubaral, if you have any tax problems, all you have to do is go to Mona. Yes. She's the assistant commissioner, if I'm not mistaken, of taxes. So, you know, she can write something and get you arrested for not paying your taxes also, huh? Yes, yes, and sir, you also, right. But here she comes, so humble, you know, as one of our alumni, just doing things so well for us. She couldn't come yesterday because she had to sit in her, you know, Mem Saheb table, table, and do lots of file work. But today she has spared her time. So I'm just giving a sample, you know, of the kind of people that have come out from us. And we are so proud of every one of them, whether you're occupying a high chair or anything else. And even as a mother and as a father in their families, somehow we know in our hearts, we cannot trace the life of all of y'all, but we know in our heart of hearts that y'all are all very, very good people. Good people. And people with principle, that is one thing, you know, we are so proud of. Honest, hardworking, and people who can be trusted. I think at the end of the day, you can have all the knowledge you want, but you must be a good human being. And you must be somebody who contributes to the state and to your own people. And I think that those who have passed through us, that is what they have done. And those who are still with us, surely they will aspire in some form or other. Of course, y'all might be thinking, oh God, you know, what tall claims this one is making. After all, we sit only for 4 semesters with them, 2 years. And some of them are here for their MPhil and PhD. But other than that, we had our school, we had our college. Well, no, it is with pride and confidence I'll say that we kind of, by the time y'all come to us for your MA, for your post-graduation, I feel that we are the ones who tie up the loose ends for y'all, you know, in your life. Kind of still baggy and thinking, where am I going, who am I, where am I moving? But I think it is with us that y'all find an objective and a firm footing. For that, yes, we take credit and we proudly do so. Thank you so much. I really wish, you know, our department, I'll tell you very frankly, we don't make a big noise about ourselves. We don't brag and things like that. I mean, within the university campus. But there is this undercurrent, you know, in the campus of competition between departments. And today, I really wish that many of our friends who came yesterday, our senior friends, some of them, you know, thinking, what do they do in English department? If only they could see, because we don't make enough noise. You know, we don't. And we have teacher groups and all that. You should see the kind of things that they post. Every little bit of thing they will post. But we hardly ever do this because, you know, we don't want to be a nuisance. So in that sense, I would also like to say that Department of English has quality. We are cultured, we are refined, and we try to maintain that as well. So with this, I say another big thank you. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Professor Margaret Sozama. And now we have come to the last part of our program. We will have the valedictory speech from our head of department, Professor Margaret L. Patsuao. Let us welcome her with a clap.
Thank you, everyone. This brings us to the closure of the official celebrations of the Ruby Jubilee of the department, as we all know, which started from yesterday, the 30th and the 31st of October 2019. So officially closure, 40 years, but of course the beginning of, you know, the 41st year, so to say, and of course the beginning of new life, basically, and celebration for all of us. As we said yesterday, I would like to reiterate, this has been a time of honoring the past, celebrating the present, and of course envisioning the future. We are in the midst of the celebrations of the present, and we've been very, very happy, as our, as Professor Zama has already denoted. We are happy with the celebrations, more than happy, basically. We are truly grateful to the Almighty at this point of time for having been with us through 2017. As we had indicated, some of us were not here yesterday at the inaugural. So this idea was mooted in 2017 at the department in February, throughout the entire 2017, and then of course 2018, and now towards the end of 2019. And we have done this, like we have said, we have collected a whole lot of money, 2,93,000 rupees, this too from alumni, faculty contributions, well-wishers who've been part of the department basically, and without any penny, any paisa taken from the administration. So this has been concerted effort from the Department of English, because, and we, in the department, we not only participate in terms of getting our degrees, in terms of getting our attendance, in terms of, you know, getting a whole lot in academics, but this also basically goes to show that we totally belong. It's not merely participation, but it is belonging. And therefore, it is important that the celebration is for all of us, as it truly has been. The next, you know, yesterday people were telling us that in the next 10 years or so, you can get ready to celebrate Golden Jubilee. We all understand that. Chronologically, obviously, 50 years, Golden Jubilee. How many of us are going to be still around at that point of time? In terms of even living and breathing is the big fat question. And also, even if we are around at that point of time, some of us may have retired also. Some of us may have branched on to something else also in terms of the faculty. As for alumni, it is our hope and prayer that you all will be still around and perhaps be faculty of the department also, some of us. Or otherwise, you know, branching on, as we've already heard, into different walks of life. But nevertheless, wherever we are, it is important that we will continue to do well under the great big umbrella of the Department of English, alumni and faculty, retired faculty, serving faculty, nevertheless. This has been a great moment, a very, very proud moment for all of us. We don't have to go through the entire details. Our thanks yesterday, we had vote of thanks from Professor Lal Rindiki, Tifa and I. And yesterday, very, very timely in terms of the celebrations, we had two faculty who had promotions, Professor Lal Rindiki, Tifa and I, and also Dr. Sherry L. Tsangte, who's on childcare leave. Sherry, of course, is not here with us, very much part and parcel of the entire organizing committee, and is with us as she reassures us from our WhatsApp group, departmental faculty WhatsApp group, very much with us in spirit. So she's now associate professor. Again, you know, that upward movement for people in the faculty and also for all our students as well. We're totally grateful to the kind of help that we've had from varying quarters. We had our founder faculty, Professor Baral, who had come here. We also had a whole lot of our invitees. Actually, you know, from that list of invitees, we could not be as inclusive as we wanted to because of the paucity of space and because of the fact that, you know, this is going on during classes. But out of the entire lot of invitees, we had actually, by name, in terms of the cards, we had made out 100 people. Of course, this is like, you know, notwithstanding the fact that our students, our alumni, we had not given them the invitation cards basically, but out of that there were only two people who did not turn up.
and you know, on medical grounds, that too. Otherwise, everyone came. We had totally full house, and if there was a term other than full house, that would have been it also. The catering, the physical, the financial arrangements, everything went on totally tip-top. We have had such pleasant weather also. We could not have had better aspects in terms of the Ruby Jubilee celebration. So this is, like we said, closure for 40 years. It is our hope and prayer, of course, that as faculty and as Department of English, and also we are moving on to greater things, hopefully. We have already asked in the year 2017, we had asked for change of nomenclature to the UGC from Department of English to Department of English and Culture Studies. So, similarly, also a move away from the school in terms of School of Education, bifurcating, and then a separate school altogether. But what is happening now is what we have checked, the latest position being that at least for our department, Department of English and Culture Studies, it's been approved by the MHRD, but the paperwork is stranded at the UGC. Hopefully, in the next year or so, we should be getting that particular move away from, you know, not only the school, but also in terms of the department. And so, therefore, the vision will continue. So we are not going to expand now in terms of the vision and what we would like to do or what we would not like to do, because we've already done quite a bit. We would like to carry on that tradition of excellence also, striving for that excellence. We are looking for excellence. We're looking for a whole lot in terms of that. We're also looking for blessings from the Almighty. But it is important that in order to live that well, we have to, you know, in order to garner all that, all of us should remember that life is about a code of ethics. Sometimes some of us may sound a bit strict. Some of us may not be sounding that way too. While we say that it is fine for that entire lot, it is important to remember that life is about ethics. It is about living right. And sometimes, you know, we hear things like, it's the department. The department is so strict. We're very careful, you know, quick to say that we're very strict. But, you know, strictness is not the word. It's actually because we abide by the rules and the regulations. Yesterday in his inaugural speech, if some of us will recall, the VC was actually recalling an incident that had taken place last year in terms of the admissions. As a head, and at that point of time, being, you know, one of the very junior people, let me just share this with y'all. In the administration, when I had gone, I was badgered to, you know, keep taking people, especially one particular candidate, in terms of the admissions. But I'm glad that the VC brought it out very beautifully yesterday when he said that, you know, there was a respect for not only the departmental committee, but also the ordinances and the rules and regulations. And if you'll understand, the VC did not use the word strict at all. It is because of these things. These are not little things. These are the things, not just big things or small things. These are the things that make our department what it is. You know, it's a matter of honor, it's a matter of pride to say that we don't just take people through push and pull at any point of time. We honor the kind of ordinances, the kind of rules and regulations that are there. We are not pushed, we are not bullied at all also. And if people call us strict because of those things, well, so be it. But it's all about living well. So in terms of closure for this particular session, what I would like to say is, if we would like our lives to be honored, if we would want that our lives are straight, and that we walk the untrodden path, it is important that we also must live commensurate to the fact that we have to live right, work hard, and play very, very fair. Thank you very much.
Thank you, the head of department, Professor Margaret El Patsua. And with that, we have come to the end of our program, not only the end of our program, but the end of our Ruby Jubilee celebrations. So, yeah, I will leave you that at that. And I just want to do one thing, because I want to count down from 1, 2, 3, and we all say, it's a wrap, and then we can go home, right? Okay, can we do that? Yes, 1, 2, 3, and it's a wrap, okay? 1, 2, 3, it's a wrap! Okay, thank you, everyone.